And I've been told that Jack should be the one to answer this, apparently. What's worse, Stonehill Hockey or Limp Bizkit lyrics?
Oh no. You're just asking me to like make Matt angry.
Tech Hockey Guide presents the Chasing McNaughton Podcast, covering the Michigan Tech Huskies and the CCHA with your host, Tim Brown, Rob Gilreath, Dustin Lindstrom, and Matt Cavender.
Welcome to episode 46 of season 5 of the Chasing McNaughton Podcast, presented by Tech Hockey Guide and recorded from the state of hockey. I'm Tim Brown, your host, and I'm joined this week by Dustin Lindstrom.
Hey, everyone.
Rob Gilreath.
Hey, guys.
And Matt Cavender.
You already know who it is, everybody, and I'm watching a video of a kid that is playing the national anthem on recorder at a hockey game that he's playing it.
Oh, nice.
I'm going to have to send that to Nick to put in the notes. That's pretty fantastic.
All right.
That sounds like a tournament thing.
With the Mason Cup playoffs upon us and Michigan Tech hosting Minnesota State, we have Jack Hittinger from USCHO to discuss the CCHA overall. Thanks for joining us again, Jack.
Thanks for having me. I don't have a red hat to put on. I'm sorry.
This week, we'll talk about Mankato's season, the Michigan Tech series with Bowling Green State, preview the CCHA playoffs, and ask Jack a few Patreon questions. We'll probably touch on the two coach fire or the coach firing and the coach retirement that we have heard so far, correct?
It's the only two I've heard of.
Yeah. We'll see if Matt's tidying up his resume or not. And go from there. And we have a new patron officially. He paid his payment cleared this morning. So thank you, Paul Durst, for signing up for an annual pass at the black level in honor of you joining us. Both Matt and I are wearing our red hats backwards, and Dustin has put on the closest thing he has to a red hat, which is one of his cowboy hats. So
it's not a cowboy hat.
That's a fedora. If I've ever seen one.
I don't even know what kind. Is it a fedora? I don't know.
I don't know if it's a proper fedora, but okay. It's more of a...
It's old-timey.
It's more
Swedish.
Of a...
It's Swedish.
Jones hat.
Okay. Yeah, maybe. It's a little more of like a... Yeah. It might be something you see like a Chicago gangster from the 1920s wear. Does that work?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Anything else? We get everything there? I mean, I'm sure we'll talk about the Minnesota State high school tournament since Jack's here, and we can let
that's number one priority.
Abby and Rob's eyes roll over for a bit.
Oh, my name has not been changed yet. Thank you.
All right, we'll be right back with Jack Hittinger after a little thank you notes and a brief note from our sponsors. We fund everything at Tech Hockey Guide from listeners like you. You can show your support by becoming a patron at patreon.com/techhockeyguide. Whether you're interested in question priority, access to patron-only Zoom chats with coaches and players, in-stat deep dives, extended versions of the podcast, unedited video or audio, early access, or commercial-free listening, there's a level for you. We also now have 15% discounts off annual memberships with tiers ranging from $2 to $50 per month. Again, sign up at patreon.com/techhockeyguide. Are you in the market for insurance? Have your rates for home, auto, boat, or more been increasing way beyond inflation? If so, maybe it's time you spoke with Aaron Pietola and the team at Arcadia Insurance Group. Serving Michigan, Minnesota, Wisconsin, Illinois, Indiana, Ohio, and more, who better to serve you than a former Michigan Tech player? For more information, call 866-511-1069 or go to arcadiaagency.com.
Just looking at the schedules while we've been talking, and there's one that I'm almost like afraid to bring up. All of our win streaks have been exactly three this year when we've hit a streak.
We haven't won four games in a row.
We have not won four games in a row all year long.
You want to know what? Last week, Rob said that Bowling Green was not going to end their season on a 6-game win streak, and then immediately got streak, that yep. opinion. Yeah, on a 6-game losing streak, and then his opinion there immediately got dunked on. So
I'm not having any. There's no opinion about the size of the streak. I'm merely presenting facts here that we have not hit 4 yet this year.
That's
I
true.
Haven't
but
said
keep
whether
bringing
I don't
it up.
Think we're going to hit that.
Keep bringing it up. Will. It's working out for us. Let's see. I think we can make it 4, maybe 5. We'll see if we can make it 6.
I wouldn't mind 5 because that throws me in a panic schedule trying to figure out how to get to wherever the hell we got to go. I honestly didn't see that. I didn't think that was going to happen with the way the year went, but we've
if it's
decided...
5, please, God, make it 6. Please, please, please.
Right.
If they end up going to the tournament because they somehow win these next two games.
I know, they're going to get their ass kicked.
They're
going to
get pounded by Boston College.
I know.
But hey, listen, we had the year where American International upset St. Cloud as the number one seed in the tournament. And I think that, you know, this Tech team is probably stronger
than
that AIC
team. That's the one you picked.
St. Cloud has a little scar tissue there that Boston College doesn't really have.
That is the more recent example. I understand that I don't live in Minnesota and don't have that, you know, Holy Cross one to pull out of my ass all the time, but that's the one that I remember because I like AIC.
Well, didn't it happen to Minnesota State too? Or were they not? They weren't
Minnesota. No, they were a one seed, but they weren't the overall.
No, okay. I thought they were number one overall when they got beat by RIT.
I don't know.
I'd have to look back.
I don't know.
I just know
the one that makes me upset for Minnesota State was when they got beat by Providence when they were the one seed at like the East Regional and it was like all
in Providence.
Yeah, it was like in Providence and Providence got to use like all that was all that right, was a load of crap, but you don't need to go down that.
Overall seed that year.
Was that
Mankato was the number one overall seed that
were
year.
They? Okay.
Yeah, they got
beat by RIT. That was the RIT year that they were number one overall, right? Yeah.
In 2015.
Yeah.
Yeah, because they won a game when they were number one overall in 2021.
Yes.
And then they
lost. That was the monkey off the back game.
And then they lost. Yep. They lost as the third overall in 2019, the sixth overall in 2018. I just have a spreadsheet for all this, guys. I like being able to see it easily.
I don't think I was also just going to say, like, I mean, it's possible that the CCHA team is going to play Boston College, but there are a couple teams lower in the pairwise that if they win their conference tournament, I think that will mean that it's not necessarily a lock. So I think Niagara maybe is down there and maybe AIC.
Yep. Depending on how bad they are, the only thing they have going for them compared to Tech is they play better teams to get there.
Yeah.
So they might.
Even if it's just like a Dartmouth or Rensselaer, shout out Perry. could open for some also craziness like
so we got Rensselaer, Harvard, St. Lawrence, Miami, Niagara, Lowell, Union, but they would probably jump Bemidji or Minnesota State and Merrimack. Those are all the teams that are currently below Minnesota State in pairwise that still have a chance of making the tournament.
Some of those Hockey East schools, though, if they go on a run, they are going to shoot up that.
Yeah, if Lowell somehow wins, they have a 0.0% chance of doing it. More than likely, they would catapult themselves to like 29th in the pairwise.
Maybe more on the Atlantic Hockey or one of those ECAC teams.
Yep.
But if that happens, then you could see one of the CCHE teams going to Sioux Falls or something, which I think...
To play a different Boston school.
or North Dakota.
Or North Dakota, yeah.
Yep.
I think you'd like... Just from a CCHA fan perspective, I think most of the fans in the league would prefer to drive
the St. Louis or Sioux Falls. Yeah.
Yeah.
More fans. I know. I mean, Bemidji would definitely prefer that. Like everybody would, but you also think that like some of these teams more familiar with the North Dakotas or Omaha's of the world, or it could be North Dakota. I guess you never know, but you'd think that like you'd like that matchup better than sort of a more unknown one, but maybe not. I don't know.
It certainly would make things easier on the Misfits, right? To get there. I guess possibly. I guess I don't actually know how much better like St. Louis is from Houghton compared to like Boston. That can't be a whole lot better.
I've made that drive.
Houghton to Boston?
No, Houghton to St. Louis for the St. Louis Frozen Four.
Okay. I know anyway. My girlfriend asked me if Tech somehow won the conference tournament, if I would go to the regional, and I was like, no, I'm not spending my hard-earned money to go watch them as a 16. Like, that's, I was like, but if they won the first game, I'd probably try and see if I could get a flight to the regional final.
I would,
since there's a day in between now.
I'd consider driving to Sioux Falls.
I would probably drive to Sioux Falls or St. Louis, but I'm not like blowing my miles to fly to somewhere out east, I don't think, this year.
I'm a dumbass. If work, well, let's hey, take it fine. Off. I'm going.
Yeah.
I may be traveling for work that may screw it up, but if we end up going, I haven't missed one yet. Not going to start now.
I've missed one.
Can it be as bad as what happened last year? I don't think so. Let's be honest.
I mean, how could it get much worse?
I don't think it can be, simply because if it was 12-0,
right?
Against BC, that's a little more expected than when we actually thought we had a chance against Penn State, right? Like, you're going to go into that if you're playing BC or BU, no matter how it shapes up. If you're playing one of those two, like, you're not going into that game like thinking you have more than a dumb and dumber chance of winning that game, right? Like, you're telling me there's a chance and that's it. Like, and if you somehow win it, that's like a magical moment that you got to be at, Rob. Well, yeah, well, I watched much on TV from somewhere else.
I think you guys are a little damaged Tech fans just because you've had some pain against those. Not from in a bad way. I just like, there's a history of the CCHA or now CCHA teams going and beating a bigger seed. I think it can happen. It's not unheard of for it to happen. I think college hockey, there's parity. I'm trying to talk you down a little bit, Tim.
It has happened once in the history of the new WCHA, CCHA.
Well, I'm just saying, even like a couple years ago during the COVID year, Wisconsin, everyone assumed Cole Caulfield, Wisconsin, was going to beat Bemidji. And they didn't. They got their butts kicked.
So, I think all they had was a Cole Caulfield on ice tracker that whole game. That was the most ridiculous game I'd ever watched.
I bet. I don't know if we said it, but I feel like we predicted that, didn't we? Like, we thought that Bemidji would eat up that team because they were so one-dimensional.
I'm pretty sure we did. Pretty sure we did. At least some of us did.
Probably did, but I'm just saying.
But that's also, like, I mean, I guess Bemidji wasn't... like, it's hard to judge that year because it wasn't a true pairwise year, right? So they were the 10, but you don't really know what that actually would have been in a real season.
It was a weird year, but I think that Wisconsin team was still stacked. Like, maybe not as much as this either BU or BC team, but I think
but they were considered the, like, seven. Well, they must have been considered like the 7 because Bemidji was considered the 10, as far as I can tell.
Yeah.
The only true time it happened was 2016 when Ferris went in as 30th in pairwise and won. Yeah.
But I mean, that's just all this just to say that team was pretty stacked. I mean, with Caulfield, they had Dylan Holloway, they had Linus, what's his face, the Swedish guy.
I think part of the problem that year was, like, the Big Ten at that time yet, I think, just played this style that because they didn't have to play anybody else, like, they were not prepared play a team that wasn't a Big Ten team.
Also, turns out in hindsight, they maybe weren't very well coached.
Yeah, they may have gotten there in spite of their coach, huh?
Right.
Right. But yeah, I mean, Ferris has 2 tournament wins since the big reshuffle, the first one. Minnesota State has 4. 3 of which came 2 years ago, and then Bemidji has the one against Wisconsin, and that's all the tournament wins the conference has, or these 8 teams have over the last 10 years. Yeah, can't believe it's been that long now. But I mean, we're definitely hardened from how frustrating it has been since Tech has been part of the conversation again.
Recency bias with Tech as well, just.
Yeah. Yeah,
obviously, the way that Tech has lost has been may probably be more painful than some of the other ones.
The big blowouts suck and all, but like the Notre Dame game where literally you go from You know, the puck is like right there on the line to a breakout, and Notre Dame goes down and scores, or Riley Sweeney's, you know, blue line incident when we're pressuring and buzzing and ugh. So yeah, there's been bad games. Don't get me wrong, last year sucked. But
yeah, but the thing about last year sucked, but the thing about last year was after like 10 minutes into that game, we all knew what was going on, and it was just like whatever. Like,
it wasn't heartbreak. It was, oh, this sucks. Yeah.
Right. It's a
different thing. I'm really glad that you made us make the plan to spend like fly in and out of New York, because that made the trip far better than it would have been if we had just freaking gone to Allentown and our team gets.
We could have ate
like
more
that.
Scrapple.
Yeah. Right. I mean, I'm still talking up trying to take my daughter to go to Peter Luger sometime, and we'll get dinner for one, because I think that'll be plenty for the two of us. But yeah, like the experience of that trip made it okay. But that game, like, I mean, well, and it also helped watching Michigan kick the crap out of Bowlgate, right?
Like, that didn't help. That didn't help anything. Pissed me off more.
I was hoping I could at least see one team I was preferring to see win.
Being up there in the press box with the scratches was a memorable commiseration moment that I'll never forget, though.
Yeah. Those kids from Colgate were just like, what are we supposed to do?
Kid from Colgate's comments is, you know, we barely win to get here, and then we show up again and happen to play the hockey equivalent of SEAL Team 6. Was pretty much perfect.
Yeah. I'm actually kind of surprised looking back that we've had 10 years of the reshuffle, and our conference has put two teams in the tournament, or would have put two teams in the tournament likely 8 times.
Yeah.
Actually 3 teams 1 year. So like, I think that's just kind of crazy that it was that, that we have been that successful. I know there's a lot of talk about how we're like Atlantic Hockey West this year.
I think that's fair this year, but that what irritates me is when people try to like make that comparison as like an always and forever thing, and I just simply do not agree with that. I think the stats are definitely against that. I think the CCHA is a much stronger conference and a much more desirable place for players to play. Like, I get that this year it the optics are not in favor of that, but historically, since the formation of the league and the breakaway from the WCHA, I think it's been a much stronger league than Atlantic Hockey, and it frustrates me when people like lump the two together.
Yep.
I think that's from people that don't watch or see very many
non-Big Ten or NCHC games. Yeah.
Like, I think it's actually impressive what the league has been able to do, because 90% or 80% of our non-conference is against two of the best conferences in the country. Like,
I think
like Big Ten NCHC is clearly as a group better than ECAC East
Hockey East.
Yeah.
I think fans and also media that cover Big Ten and NCHC, I mean, they obviously see CCHA teams a lot more. And I think they would tell you that like the CCHA is not anywhere near Atlantic Hockey quality, but I think it's people, probably mostly probably people on the East Coast, that just don't see the CCHA because they don't have the opportunity to, because it doesn't get out East very much and games are on flow.
Or the one series that they did see was Bowling Green when they were in shambles in the first month.
Hurst or whatever.
Or that kind of stuff. Yeah, that kind of stuff. Like, it's just, like, they need to be better in non-conference, but it's really hard to be, I don't know, it's just hard to come out of the gate as strongly as this conference needs to when this conference is not built on skill, which means it's more about systems and playing as a team. And that's harder to do from day one.
And I think this year, especially, just some of those early season games could have gone either way. And then that would have helped a little bit of the pairwise, just thinking about like Bemidji played Duluth early in the season, Boston overtime after blowing a two goalie or something, like just stuff like that. Like Mankato losing in overtime to North Dakota. I mean, you guys had a couple of those overtime. Didn't both those ECAC games that you played, you guys probably could have won. I feel like stuff like that is like, oh, those are really close games that don't seem like a lot, but they definitely make a difference at the end of the season when you're looking at their.
Right.
Yep. And then and it doesn't help anything that the like how important to pairwise it is that the like handful of games we played against Atlantic Hockey, and they were all against Ferris and Bowling Green. And Bowling Green was in shambles, like I said, when those games happened. So like how much difference, I don't know. It'd be interesting to see just how much our RPI for everybody improves just from Ferris State and Bowling Green doing better in their Atlantic Hockey games, because it just flips, it just makes such a big difference to be compared better against that conference
Yeah,
compared to what we were.
or even just looking at like Saint, going back to St. Thomas, like they started that win against St. Cloud, that was an overtime game. Then they lost the next game, 1-0, and then they lost to Minnesota in overtime, also a game that they were leading late in that game. I mean, those two games could have been big for pairwise pushing someone up. I mean, I don't know. It's just the, like those little things don't look like when you just look at the raw record on Hockey News or whatever, the against the rest, it looks worse than it actually is. But then you look at the actual scores and you're like, oh, they're in all almost all these games, maybe one or two bad ones. I think there were a couple bad, like you said, Bowling Green shambles against Ohio State or whatever. I think they had some bad results. I know a couple teams had some bad results, but for the most part, these games were really close.
Yep. Yeah. And that's the frustrating part, is knowing that's just a few of those out of conference games flipping the other way makes such a huge difference. And the league just collectively pooped itself this year real, real hard.
Yeah.
Because I do, my expectation for the CCHA is one at large and one auto qualifier. I mean, that's where we should be.
Yeah, I think
Three,
that's
three,
at least
three,
one bubble team.
three should
Yes.
be the outlier, but it should be where we have two teams going every year.
Yes, I agree.
And not being there is frustrating to see for the league, for sure.
Yeah. I mean, I think it definitely makes things more interesting at the end of the season when you're talking about just the tournaments, and there's more optimism at the end of the season for more teams because they're not thinking about they have to win the Mason Cup to get to the tournament. There's sort of more. I remember last year there was the situation with Northern and Mankato, and I think Mankato obviously was a bubble team, and if they would have lost to Northern, I think they would have been out. But it's still you have two teams in there, so it was that was some intrigue. Right up until the end, whereas this year, I think you obviously, I think it's still going to be exciting, but you know that whoever's in is probably going to be 16 or 15 seed, so there's I think a little
Right.
bit less of that excitement from people outside who don't follow the league looking in might not be as interested. On one hand, who cares, because we know that it's an exciting league even though it's not maybe the most skilled, but it's still a good league to cover and watch if you're a fan, I think.
For sure. Anything else we want to talk about college hockey before your eyes glaze over, Matt and Rob?
Yeah, I'm just gonna watch this half of my screen where the web browser is while we talk tournament.
Do we want to get to coach firings?
Oh
Yeah.
yeah, we can talk about that. So let's start with the retirement and the potential job opportunity for Mr. Cavender.
Yeah.
Stonehill's coach has decided that one victory in D1 hockey is enough, so he is now retiring. And
Well, it's good to
I,
go out on the top of the mountain,
a
you know?
much
Right.
deserved ride off into the sunset, let me
Right.
tell you.
Right. At least he doesn't go into the record books over, right?
That's true. I mean, man, I was going nuts when Stonehill got that one win. That was awesome. But I hope that means good things for the athletes. I think they deserve better than what they've gotten so far in terms of support from the staff in the school. And I hope that the institution sees this as an opportunity to make the program a little bit more competitive. But on that note, have your people call my people. I know exactly how to talk to these I know exactly how to talk to these overage USHL kids and how to get them to commit to being a little like not too far away from Boston. And suddenly we're looking at a middle of the pack team, baby. We might we all we gotta do is get lucky with a couple games. Maybe we're a low seed in the tournament. We'll see how it goes. Have your people call my people.
And I do think we forgot to talk about Lindenwood parting with their coach at the end of February there.
That one makes less sense to me. I felt like they were on a, I mean, they did lose a Stonehold. Maybe that's what did it. But I felt like they were on a much better trajectory towards, like, because, you know, like, new programs are going to struggle in the beginning most of the time, unless you're the Vikings for some reason. They're doing great so far. But I thought he was doing pretty good getting a excuse me, getting a new program kind of on the map. But you know, good luck to them. I see good things being in St. Louis. I think they're primed to do well. I think they seem like they have much more of a clear direction than Stonehill, which I know is like not the greatest comparison you could make for something, but as it were, if there's a good fit there, it could be a really attractive option for a young and up and coming coach.
Did you guys know he played for North Dakota?
I did.
No, I did not.
I think I did know that, yeah.
I'm just looking it up, and he's basically been their head coach since 2010 for the club team, even.
They played in Grand Forks last year. I think Schlossman had a feature on him.
Of course he
That's how I know it was because of Schlossman tweeting.
And well, also just because I think Sambo is kind of a weird dude. Like, just like he's kind of not your. He doesn't. He's not the type of guy that is going to give you coach speak in an interview. So I think that's why he's memorable. Like, he is just kind of a speaks his mind, kind of weird, interesting guy in a good way. So reading that interview and thinking, oh, he seems like a cool guy. So I hope he finds another job because I don't know. He just seemed like an interesting dude.
Yeah,
Well,
like, and maybe
Stonehill's
it's
open.
maybe.
Matt, if he was gonna send his resume, like, well, you remember the guy a couple years ago that applied to coach North Dakota, and he was like, "I'm just gonna chuck the pigskin." You remember that guy?
No,
I
but I
do
do
not
remember
know.
that we, because, you know, Augie on our staff applied to be the first head coach of Augustana, and he was like, "Well, my qualifications are my name is Augie, and I like hockey." And he like, I think he had a whole Twitter thing about where he put out his resume and why you should do it.
I remember he's from North Dakota, and like the North Dakota football job came open, and he sent a resume.
Sites playing Madden as experience.
His resume was I
Wait,
like.
okay, so UND head coach, was this for the football team?
No
Yeah.
punting.
Okay, because if this was for the hockey team and he cited Madden, that would have been way funnier.
You could just like do something similar, just like I don't even know what your philosophy would be. To always pull the goalie.
This quote for this initial quote is pretty awesome. My football philosophy is basically an attacking one. We're going to give air raid a whole new definition. Theoretically, how many times do you think a team can pass in a game? Challenge accepted. We're going five wide and chucking the pigskin all over the place. Never punt. Onside. Every time. Chip Kelly will be calling me to learn my offense. We'll put an exciting brand of football. We'll pack him into the Alaris Center night in and night out. Go ahead and blow the roof off the place and add about 35,000 seats to it.
I like the
love
first paragraph where it says no mercy and mercy's crossed off and says punting.
I just
I
love
mean,
the
hey,
challenge accepted.
punting is just glorified giving up, and I love that this man has just not got no give up in him. He's just ready to
I
go.
will say this. I do think every NFL team should hire a dude for clock management purposes that has played a crap ton of Madden, because we all seem to be better at it than coaches are when you play Madden. Like, you just get a better sense of what the hell you're supposed to do with your timeouts. I don't know.
The thing is, I think
But
there's an
that's funny.
opportunity for someone
Don't,
to
you know, they already have like the ass wiping coordinator. Do we really need to have the clock management coordinator?
or the get back coach, like they stay off the line, yeah.
And hockey can't get a fucking goalie coach without like kicking and screaming for it. But, you know, suddenly now we have a clock management. I don't know. I hear what you're saying, but it's just a bridge too far for
Well, I
me.
wasn't saying college. I don't college, whatever. I was
Okay.
saying
All
the
right.
pros.
Yeah. All right. All right.
I think college hockey should have a clock management coach.
All right.
To tell coaches when to pull the goalie. That's all I do.
Challenge accepted.
And I guess the biggest news we heard about Lindenwood was the rumor that McCault is a candidate. I think that was put out on Twitter, was it not? I believe I saw that. Which would be certainly would be interesting for him to end up there, trying to kind of rebrand his career after Mel's tumble. So, okay.
I guess The main thing, I don't know if we even I mean, the I think the big one was about Eigner, but
yeah,
do we that is the most surprising one? I think it kind of took most people by surprise. I guess I look back at the track record, and I think when you look at what he's done, I think he went to the tournament the first year he was there and hasn't done a lot since. So it kind of makes sense. But I think the way that it happened after the season, and they've been playing pretty well up until the last 3 weeks or so. So that, I think I was kind of surprised that it happened so quickly. I don't know what you guys think.
Yeah, I think it was surprising. But like you said, when you look back at the actual record and like the lack of CCHA playoff or, you know, conference playoff success, like it, I guess it makes some sense. But it's also going to be really hard to foresee how, like, one of the questions you always get when you fire a coach, or when all one of the things you always see on the internet when you fire a coach, is how are you going to do better than what you had, right? Like,
I have a name. Mel Pearson.
Mel Pearson.
Oh, come on, God. Mel.
And you know why it works? Because he could still be close enough to go watch his favorite team on bye weeks. He could be just down the road from Ann Arbor.
That's fair. But I don't know. I think I get where they're coming from. I think ever since Bergeron left, and I think it's kind of interesting that that hasn't really worked out for Miami either. They're really calling for his head over there as well. But, you know, he's only had the one playoff series victory. It was against Tech. But that was his first year as a coach. And what does that say about, you know, his recruiting, his play style? And, you know, I think given everything that's happened in Bowling Green in the past year, it's kind of a chance for that institution to try to wipe the slate clean and try to do something new next year. I think that's, it's more that than anything. But I think that, you know, I don't know if necessarily Eigner is a bad coach. I don't know if it's necessarily, because, you know, this is someone's job and livelihood we're talking about. I don't know if he necessarily deserved to lose it. But from Bowling Green's perspective, I can understand why they would make that decision.
Just to set the record straight, Eigner's one playoff series victory is against Alaska. Bergeron's last first-round victory was against Tech.
All right. Well, I stand corrected. Thank you, Tim.
I think that was the COVID year, too, the Alaska one.
Yep, we won the, like, Tech won our first round series, Bowling Green won their first round series, and then the tournament, the season was over.
It was pretty good that year, because it looked like they played Alaska in the first round on the road, so that was like a road a road win.
Yeah, they were the fifth seed that year, so their 4-5 matchup. They were actually 21st in the pairwise as the season ended, but they were fifth in the conference somehow.
You know, I'm looking too. The 2021, I think they were pretty good.
Yeah, they just got screwed because they fell apart at the end, and the tournament, the committee couldn't put in four CCHA teams.
So I mean, so I don't know. Yeah, I mean, they haven't had necessarily had success, but I think when you look at almost his entire coaching career has been in the post-COVID era, which I think kind of a maybe an unfair way to judge how successful he's been. I don't know. It seems very unfortunate that it came to this, because I do think that he did a pretty good job with what he had, but I don't know. It's hard to say.
I did. I might as well put this out there since I put it on Discord anyway. I put my tinfoil hat on earlier today. When the firing was announced, and speculated that maybe there was more to the Swinkler Bowling Green team thing than what was made public, and the fact that they didn't recover and do well enough, it was kind of like a time to move on. But they found a way to save face by not firing him in the moment, and instead waited till the end of the year. Obviously that does, very conspiratorial, but it kind of made
sounds
sense
like
to me until we looked at
speculation.
The record. You like that?
I like it. Let's run with it.
It belongs on the podcast, that's for sure.
Yep.
Yeah. I don't know. I've read the police report. I don't know if there is anything that's really to that. I think,
yeah,
it's probably more to just, I don't know. It seemed like that whole situation was maybe Swinkler didn't get along with a lot of people, and there were just some clashes of personalities. So he maybe it doesn't even do good to speculate, but I just think that
and it could just be as much as he wasn't necessarily responsible, but he's still in charge, so the buck stops with him in some respect. So I think that can play into why he was let go, even if it was mostly about results.
I think maybe that's what I'm saying. I think performance probably is most of it, and you know, I mean, maybe this is all just speculation. So it's like it could be that there maybe have been just some culture issues and they never really resolved them, so they thought it would be best to part ways and try someone else. So that seems the most likely than a conspiratorial tinfoil hats, like, oh well, they were wrong, blah, 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 or whatever, about Swankler and wanted to do this or that. That seems a little more far-fetched to me, but that's okay.
I like baseless speculation, though.
We let Dave Ellis talk crap about stuff at Bowling Green. I might as well have my own rumor that I start, right? So moving on from college hockey. Well, I guess first things first, Talon's up, whatever. I forget his full name. Matt,
do you Talon's remember? Up, Puck Down.
Puck Down. Speculated on some early candidates and threw out Jason Herter's name as one of them, as well as Bilsma, who always comes up whenever Bowling Green has an opening. I think it's far-fetched to think that any coach that's having remote success at the pro level would ever consider going to college hockey at this time, because it's such a mess with the name, likeness,
with this
stuff.
And just the landscape of what's going on right now, yeah.
Yeah. And the portal stuff, like, it just seems like too much.
With the portal stuff, I don't know if you saw the people were talking about today. Portal is a little bit
they redefine the windows, right?
Like the windows start sooner, though. So I think people are thinking that the teams are gonna want to hire as soon as possible so they can get started, which I think is much different than it has been in the past.
Yeah. Well, the window starts later, right?
Oh yeah. Well, I don't remember.
Because it used to be the Monday after Selection Sunday. Now it's a week after Selection Sunday. But the window is also shorter to go into the portal.
Yeah, that's...
But the moment that Eigner was fired, all of the Bowling Green players can go into the portal now. You're not right. That they couldn't anyway, because their season's over. But so that'll be interesting to see how that plays out. But yeah, it also does feel like it puts... One of the biggest things that I think the portal is ultimately going to do is speed up hiring processes, which I'm not sure is a great thing, but it's going to have to, because you can't keep, like, how many players are you going to lose to the portal if you don't have a coach for 3 months, right?
Yeah.
You just can't do that anymore. So that'll be definitely an interesting thing. If I was Bowling Green and Jason Herter wanted to go there, I would jump at that. Let's just say that. I think his track record as an assistant coach at both Duluth and Western Michigan has been stellar, and I can't imagine why anyone wouldn't want to hire him if he wanted to come to your school.
Yeah.
Fibke Dental is a general dentistry practice located in downtown Rhinelander, Wisconsin, home of the Hodag. Look online at FibkeDental.com or find them on Facebook. They do pain-free dentistry for kids, adults, people that went to great schools, and people that ended up at Northern Michigan. Stop in and say hi between 8 and 5 and tell them THG sent you. That is FibkeDental.com.
Do you work in manufacturing, product design, or product development? Is your business trying to improve efficiency while also producing at scale? Livonia Technical Services can help. They provide world-class quality improvement training and consulting for failure modes and effect analysis, product development, and cost reduction. All things that could help Northern Michigan assemble a competent defense. If you think your business could use a prevention mindset and reduce manufacturing costs, a partnership with Livonia Technical Services might be right for you. Check them out at livoniatech.net. That's LIVONIA tech.net.
So one other hockey, one other thing we can talk about is, and related to pulling the goalie, is the Wild pulled the goalie during a regular season overtime game.
I didn't realize there was a points deduction if you don't win for that.
That's why you don't see it very often.
Yeah. Isn't it one of the guys in the KHL that does it every time or something?
I believe that's Fedorov for I believe he's CSKA. I forget. It's one of the Red Army teams, either SKA or CSKA. But yeah, he does it like every time. But yeah, if you get scored on the empty net, you don't get the loser point. That's why people don't tend to do it. But the Wild are really trying.
One point
to
did not help them at all, so they went for two.
That's a good way to put it. Yeah, they're really strapped to get those points to get into playoffs, and decided to go balls out for the win, and it paid off for them. And I got to admit, it was cool to watch. I thought it was neat. I'll give it to the Wild. How about it?
All right, moving on to Patreon questions. So Jack can get out of here because he probably didn't expect to be here for 2 hours. What from our new patron, and in honor of his last name also being Durst, he has a question, and I've been told that Jack should be the one to answer this. Apparently, what's worse, Stonehill Hockey or Limp Bizkit lyrics?
Oh no, you're just asking me to like make Matt angry.
Don't you talk too bad about the absolute wordsmith of our generation, Fred Durst.
Oh, man, this is like the worst question that anyone's ever asked me. I don't know how to answer this. I would say that, I guess Stonehill's worse.
I was about to say, be realistic here. Stonehill has one win. You at least got to admit you bob your head a little bit to Roland or something.
We're not saying that Limp Bizkit's in the NCHC or Big Ten or Hockey East or anything like that. They're somewhere towards the bottom of Atlantic hockey, but they're still better than Stonehill, right?
Yeah, I guess so.
All right, and then the other question from the one and the only Jonathan Zemaitis, do Lego people live in houses made of their own flesh?
Oh,
this one could also be applied to gingerbread.
I think gingerbread people is a more
gingerbread's an easier question.
Legos have flesh? If they're just like painted on, they're just like skeletons with paint.
Would you consider the Lego then to be more of a cyborg than like an individual?
Yeah, I don't think cyborgs aren't people, so neither are Legos. I don't know what I'm talking about at this point, but
that's okay. You're giving the people the content they want either way.
Legos are skeletons with paint. That's my point.
All right, Jack. Well, thanks for staying for pretty much the entire podcast. We appreciate you coming on last minute, as it was kind of fun trying to figure out who we should have on when we didn't know who we would be playing until 7:30, 8 o'clock last night. I forget now.
Yeah.
Thanks for coming on, Jack. Anything you want to plug?
No, I'll have a column this week. Not sure what I'm writing about. So
hockey. There you go. Start with that. Hockey. Probably playoff hockey. There you go. Even better.
Probably not going to write about Fred Durst this week, but
the more Fred Durst puns you can throw in, the better, though. You can sneak a few references into the team's role, and you know.
Yeah, you got to be like that weather guy in Austin that just throws the lyrics into the article, right?
Yeah. It was just one of those days for the Northern Michigan Wildcats.
You know what? Just for Matt, maybe I'll try and do that.
Okay, I'll put it out there if you make it happen.
When is this podcast going out?
This part will probably go out on Friday morning.
Okay, good. So maybe people can look for clues like on Wednesday when the column comes out, and then they won't know that there will be weird like Limp Bizkit references in it and stuff.
Wonderful. I love it.
I'm gonna try and do that
for get real. A whole album in song order.
Well, that would be. That's a little. That's a lot of work.
That's a lot of work.
Don't make them do that. Because most of their albums have like an intro and outro as well. So I don't think there's a reason.
Yeah, they're very like actually. Put they're like very. Intro. They're very. You know, highly. You know.
I honestly, besides Roland, I couldn't name another song.
Probably tap
break,
out
break stuff.
I probably tap out at around five Limp Bizkit songs. Got Roland, Break Stuff, Nookie, My Way.
You can't.
Nookie's probably going to be tough to work into there.
My generation.
Most editors are going to pick up on that one, I would hope.
I mean, you don't have to literally say Nookie. You can just pick some lyrics that aren't Nookie from the song Nookie.
Well, you said put the song title in there in order. Yeah. That's what we were talking about, right?
Yeah. That's good stuff, though.
It's going to be a challenge, but So I guess
solution counterfeit stuck. Nobody loves me. Sour, stalemate, clunk, faith, stink finger. There you go. Get stink that
finger.
Indigo flow, leech, and everything. That's like their is first that, album.
Oh, that's I was about to say that's $3 bill, y'all.
Yeah.
If you can figure out a way to put out the entirety of the song Chocolate Starfish and the Hot Dog Flavored Water into your article, like, I might send you $1.
$1?
Yeah. I'm strapped for cash right now, but I'd part with $1.
Oh, this is my favorite part of the podcast, when we just say stupid stuff and laugh.
All right. I need to get ready for bad guys.
All right. Well, thanks for joining us, Jack.
All right.
We'll thanks, see if Jack. Your column has yeah, any thanks, references Jack. To Limp Bizkit this week.
All right. Fingers crossed.
All right. Anything else you guys want to talk about, or we got it?
I think we're good.
I just want to know how, since I haven't checked the Discord, there's over like 200 messages while we've been talking in the general questions, or the general one.
Really?
It's that effort sometimes to keep up. It's the first time I've looked at it in a while.
Yeah, I mean, it's a lot of the younger kids getting into it there. That's what's going on.
Nobody got arrested or anything, right? Like, we don't have news to break right now.
No, I don't think so.
Hopefully it stays that way if we go to the tournament. I think that might have been a factor, but...
All right.
1 minute remaining in the podcast.
Well, that should do it for this episode of the Chasing McNaughton podcast. Please check out our Patreon and join by visiting patreon.com/techhockeyguide. Like our latest patron, Paul Durst. Thanks for signing up for an annual membership, which I believe saves you 15% on the year. But it actually does not cost us the whole 15% because we pay less in fees if you do it annually, apparently. I just figured that out today, thanks to Paul and knowing what the totals were before he signed up and after. Patrons at our white level or above get question priority. Patrons at the black level or above, like Paul Durst, get access to extra podcast content, including extended versions of almost every podcast. Patrons at the gold level or above receive access to unfiltered YouTube video of our podcast each week. And then we've got one tier higher than that, which you basically get the audio as soon as it's done processing and I can get it up on Patreon. Follow us on Twitter at Chasing Mac Pod or at Tech Hockey Guide. You can submit questions through Twitter, Facebook, or on our Patreon page. Actually, the best place to give us questions is to join our Discord, which you can get to by going to techhockeyguide.com/discord. And then that's like an open invitation to anybody that wants to sign up. Don't forget to subscribe to the podcast on Apple, Google, Spotify, wherever you get your podcasts. If you can't find the podcast in your site of choice, please let us know and we'll make it happen. Once again, thanks to our sponsors, Fibke Dental in Rhinelander, Wisconsin, Arcadia Insurance, providing insurance throughout all of the Midwest, and Livonia Technical Services. Finally, thanks to the thank you notes for all the bumpers in this week's episode. If you like what you hear, check them out at thethankyounotes.bandcamp.com.
You've been listening to the Chasing McNaughton podcast, presented by Tech Hockey Guide, covering the Michigan Tech Huskies and the CCHA.